Hi everyone, it's Tarrant.
And Stella here from Meeple University on the Dice Tower. Thanks for joining us.
Today we'll be teaching you how to play Hydroracers, the Schneider Trophy Epic. Game design by Emmanuel Abisset and graphic design by Max Panucci. The game is published by Platypus Games. We are using a prototype copy of the game here, and the game is still in development, so do expect some of the finer details of these rules to change following this video's release.
Now, let's get to it.
Hydroracers is set in the era of the Schneider Trophy, a seaplane racing event financed by Jacques Schneider in the early 20th century. Through the game, players will use their cards and the effect of draft and drag to move their seaplanes around the course, placing bets to earn money, and trying to complete the course for prestige. Each race takes place over three separate laps, and players need to make sure that their craft's reliability and their supply of cards lasts for all three laps. Have the best combined performance over three laps, and you'll win the race. This video will be broken into four sections. First, we'll talk about playing the single race mode, where whoever has the most prestige after three laps wins the game. Secondly, we'll show you how to introduce game-controlled planes, or autopilots, into your play. Third, we'll talk about the full game, a multi-race campaign where you'll use your winnings between races to purchase new cards to make your crafts more powerful. Finally, we'll talk about some of the advanced variants that you can use to increase the game's complexity. To set up for the single race, each player takes a cockpit flipped to the basic side. Take an aircraft which does not show the autopilot rules and slide it into your cockpit. Then take any grey damage tile and slide it into this slot here. Take all of your nation's components. You'll have a pilot, four betting coins, a score marker, and a deck of cards, which you shuffle and place face down. Leave out all of your nation's autopilot cards, showing this border. Score markers are placed on the zero row. Each player then takes 10 air coins and a cloth bag into which you'll place 6 grey discs and 12 yellow discs. Place the cut mode betting track onto the board. And do be aware that an earlier version of the betting board is visible in some of the clips of this video. Then place each player's seaplane in a random order on the four spaces behind the start-finish line. From front to back, this will be your starting turn order. Each player draws a hand of 3 movement cards, and you're now ready to play. Hydroracers is played in rounds, and on each round, each player will take 1 turn, starting from the player in first place and finishing with the player in the rear. On each turn, a player will move their seaplane once, and may optionally place 1 bet on the outcome of this lap. A full race is played in 3 laps, and a lap will end at the end of the round in which at least 1 player has crossed the start-finish line. At that point, you'll pause the game, resolve correct bets and scores for lap placements, and then reset to start the next lap the same way you started the first. After 3 laps are complete, leftover money is cashed in for points, and the player with the most points wins. So now let's look at a round and a turn in detail. The first step of any round is to determine draft and resistance. Whichever plane is in the lead will receive a penalty from wind resistance, so place this -1 token next to that plane. Any plane which is exactly 1 space behind the plane in front of it benefits from reduced drag, also known as draft. And so you'll place one of these +1 drafting tokens next to each of those planes. These will serve as modifiers to the player's movement this round. Next, each player will take a turn, beginning with the player who started this round in first place and finishing with whoever was last. On your turn, you must take one of 2 options. Either play a movement card from your hand and then resolve that amount of movement, or pass. To play a card, choose one from your hand and then play it face up into your personal discard pile. Note its number, then apply any draft or drag bonus you have. The result is your speed for this round, so in this case a speed of 8. Now move your plane that many spaces forward on the track. To finish your turn, redraw back to 3 cards in hand. Later in the race, if your draw deck is empty, then you will not redraw. If you choose to pass, then you do not play a card into your discard pile. You simply act as if you had played a 2. Still applying draft or drag modifiers, so here you would move with speed of 3. You must now cycle 1 card from your hand to the bottom of your draw pile, and then draw back up to 3. Passing is your only option if you're completely out of cards, and can be a good option early in the race if you want to make sure you don't run out of cards. There are 2 dangerous manoeuvres that a player can attempt during the race. The first is taking a corner too quickly. When you cross the danger line for a corner in a given turn, check your current speed, that is, your card and any modifiers. If your speed exceeds the corner's maximum speed, you've taken a risk. Draw 1 token from your cloth bag. If it's grey, simply set it aside. You've avoided damage. If the token is yellow, then place it into the next slot of your damage track. The second is to make a dangerous overtake. There may only be 1 plane per space, so if you land on top of another player, then you continue moving forward until the next open space. Then, regardless of the number of planes you overtook in this step, draw 1 danger token from your bag and resolve it as before. If you ever get a 4th damage token in a lap, then you have crashed and you're out of this lap. Remove your plane from the track and place it into the last remaining space in order, meaning that if you're the first to crash, you'll be 4th place in this lap. If you're the second to crash, you'll be 3rd place, and so on. Then do partial repairs, returning 2 of the 4 damage tokens back to your bag, ready for the next lap. You won't take any more turns this lap. In addition to your mandatory movement, you may optionally place a bet onto which plane you think is going to win this lap. Each player may do this once per lap. Choose a slot which hasn't previously been occupied by another player, except for the bottom slot, which can be occupied by any number of players. You must pay the air coin costs on that slot, and then place your token face down. Once someone crosses the start-finish line, this triggers the end of this lap. All players carry out their movement for this turn, and will still resolve any danger draws for dangerous manoeuvres they complete. Once the round is over, so is the lap, and the finishing positions for this lap are the current track order. First, resolve victory points. The leading plane gains 10 points, second place gains 5, and third place gains 2. Then pay out any points or air coins based on the betting track for any successful bets. For example, this second slot pays out only the first place getter, and so this player would gain 3 points and 10 air coins for correctly guessing first. Finally, set up for the next lap. Betting coins are returned to their owners, and planes are lined up behind the start-finish line in the order they finished the previous lap. Otherwise, the player's cockpit and play area remains exactly as it was at the end of the lap. You don't get your discarded cards back. You have to make all of your cards last for all 3 laps. And you retain any damage that you have from the previous lap. It's only a player who has crashed who gets to remove any damage tokens from the cockpit. There are only 2 other rules you need to know to play the basic race. Each player has a pilot who has a special effect. The American pilot can hold 4 cards in hand instead of 3. The French pilot does not suffer a drag penalty when leading. The Italian pilot gets an extra movement bonus when drafting. And the British pilot can draft from 2 steps behind. These bonuses may have changed, or there may be more options, by the final version of the game. Finally, some movement cards may give you other effects. This icon, for example, lets you do some running repairs to your plane when you move it slowly, this allowing you to remove 1 damage token and return it to your bag. The basic race ends after 3 laps. Players cash in any leftover air coins they have from betting at a rate of 1 point per 10 air coins. And the player with the highest score wins. You can race in Hydroracers with any number of planes, but the game really comes to life when the skies are choked up with 4 planes. To do this, you can set up the neutral planes as autopilots controlled by the game. Give the autopilot a basic cockpit and a pilot and deck, and flip over its plane to the opposite side, which shows the number of autopilot cards that the plane has. Take that many of the black and yellow autopilot cards and shuffle them in to that plane's deck. Now draw 2 cards face up and place them underneath the player board. When it is the autopilot's turn, draw 1 card from the top of its deck and then choose which card to resolve based on the following 3 steps. Firstly, if the autopilot has a card which will allow it to finish the lap, or if at least 1 plane has already finished the lap, then it will play its highest card. If not, then if there is a black and yellow autopilot card among the 3, then the player will play that. If there's no autopilot card, then that player will play according to this rule on the autopilot sheet. So here, for example, playing the weakest card. Each nation's autopilot plane has a different rule. The autopilot does not deal in air coins, but still bets for the purposes of filling up the best spots on the betting board. The first time an autopilot plane crosses a corner, then place one of its tokens onto the highest valued spot remaining to fill it up. You'll ignore these when you resolve the bets at the end of the race. And finally, the autopilots have an extra damage slot. That is, it's only after receiving its 5th yellow token that it will crash out of the lap. Other than these, the autopilots follow all normal rules. They're affected by draft and drag, as well as their pilot special effect. And they can gain points and even beat the human players. The full game of Hydroracers is a multi-race campaign. Players will start the campaign with their basic deck of movement cards, but prior to each race will go through a development phase where they'll try to get upgraded cards for a better race. To play in this mode, you'll set up the race board in the usual way, while each player will begin with 30 air coins instead of 10. Now, set up for your first development phase, and you'll do this by setting up the development board and the development bag. On the development board, you'll shuffle up all of the upgraded cards, placing them here, and then deal 6 cards out into these slots. To the bag, you'll add 12 white time markers, and 10 development markers in each human player's colour. You don't add any for the autopilots. In a development phase, one at a time, you'll draw tokens out of the bag. If the token is a white time marker, place it on the next month of the calendar track. If the token is a player-coloured token, then that player gets to take one of 3 possible actions. These are to research a development card, to engage in industrial spying, or to put on an exhibition. When you research a development, you are trying to gain that card in order to add it to your deck or tableau. Multiple players can race to develop the same card by putting their development tokens onto the same card. These icons show how many tokens you need on a card to claim it. For cruise speed, it would be 4. So blue could gain this by getting at least 4 development tokens onto this card before any other player. Alternatively, to avoid having the card snatched out from under you, when you place the second last token, you can, instead of waiting for your final token to come up, spend 5 air coins to develop the card immediately. Once you've developed a card, your development tokens are placed beside the board, and any belonging to other players are returned to the bag, ready to be drawn again later in the round. Then take the card and refill the empty slot. If the card that you develop has a number up here, then it is a movement card. You'll be adding this to your movement deck. But you must discard a movement card that is already in your deck and pay air coins equal to 10 times the movement difference between the cards. So here, 30 air coins. Shuffle the new card into your deck, placing the old one onto the top space of the industrial spying track, pushing any others down and possibly into the waste bin. Some movement cards have some bonus effects, maybe even gaining you victory points for doing stunts, while others give you flexibility on how far to move. In these cases, use the number next to the arrow when paying the air coins for the upgrade. If the card shows an icon other than a number, then this is technology or an advantage, and you won't add this to your deck, you'll add it to a permanently available tableau, giving you some extra abilities. Your second option is industrial spying, and here it requires 2 development tokens, or 1 plus the 5 air coins paid. When you successfully finish industrial spying, remove those 2 development tokens and then take any one of the face-up cards that is not in the waste bin section of the industrial spying board. The downside is that these are everyone's unwanted cards. But the upside is that it only costs 5 air coins per movement point instead of 10 to upgrade one of your movement cards with an industrial spying card. The final option is to hold an exhibition. The first time you do this, you'll place the development token on your coloured exhibition, and then, for any subsequent one, an empty public slot. Either way, you immediately gain 10 air coins. The development phase continues with players taking actions in the order that their tokens are drawn, until the 12th time token has been drawn. At that point, the development phase ends immediately. Discard all industrial spying cards, and discard all development cards that don't have any tokens on them. Any that do have tokens remain and can continue being developed next round. Remove any tokens that aren't on development cards, and then proceed to the next race. When playing with autopilots, they don't get involved in the development stage as such, but they do still gain upgrade cards, and at the start of the development phase, you'll draw 3 new cards for each autopilot. Technologies and advantages are added to their tableau, and movement cards are used to replace a non-autopilot card with a value of 2 or less, if possible. The rules within the race in this mode are unchanged from the single race, except that you'll use the trophy side of the betting board, and this is more focused on gaining money for your upgrades rather than gaining points. When the race is over, you'll then set up for the next development phase as follows. Firstly, each player takes 24 development tokens in their colour. Whoever currently has the most victory points, with ties broken by whoever finished highest in the last lap of the last race, spends one of these tokens. For each grey token that the player drew during the last race, spend another development token, before putting all grey and yellow tokens back in the bag. Each card that you've played then has a repair cost to return it to your hand, based on the number of white circles that are filled in the top left corner. So here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. The player would spend 8 development tokens and then return those cards to hand. Whatever the player has left is added into the development bag, ready for the development phase. Finally, the player who had to pay the extra token because they were leading gets to choose which map you'll play on for the next race. Play a pre-agreed number of races, then cash in your leftover air coins for points as usual, and the player with the highest score wins. For a more tactical game, you can choose to use the expert side of the cockpit board. When setting up, you'll find 4 of these damage boards and you'll insert them into their slots. There are several different ones with different numbers here, and in the final version, your plane board will tell you which number corresponds to which plane. When you draw a yellow damage marker, then you can place it onto the next numbered space of any one of the 4 areas of your choice. In the final version, these will be transparent, and so you'll be able to see the effect underneath it, and you resolve that effect. If you draw a grey token, then you place that into the next numbered spot of any area of your choice, and these will be opaque, so you do not resolve the effect underneath. The effects on this board are as follows. When you get an effect which shows one of the plane's other systems, then you must draw a danger token and place it in the next slot of that system as well, and this can lead to several effects being triggered at once. These four icons result in a passive loss of some of your ability. This one means you draw a danger token when you go around the corner at the same speed as its maximum. This one reduces your speed by 1 on all future moves. This one means you no longer use your pilot effect. And this one means your hand limit is reduced by 1. When you resolve the X, that means you crash. Remember that you don't resolve an effect if you place a grey token over it, so this would not cause a crash, but this would. If you crash, then you remove 2 of these tokens and put them back in the bag in the usual way. Even when players use the advanced cockpit, autopilots always use the basic. When using the expert cockpit, the advantage cards, which are coloured orange, are no longer treated the same as the technology cards in brown. Instead, the advantage cards resolve an immediate effect before you shuffle it back into the development deck. And that's how to play Hydroracers, the Schneider Trophy Epic.
Check out the project page of Hydroracers. We'll put a link in the description below so you can check it out. If you find this video useful, please help us by hitting that like button and subscribe to the Dice Tower if you haven't already done so.
And if you have any questions, comments or feedback, please leave that in the comment section below.
Thanks for watching and see you next time.